These particular pictures have what I would call a symbolic content. And some of the problems, by the way, are rather interesting and abstruse, meaning uncommon, because the average cartoonist doesn't deal with these questions at all. And so for your particular ideas, your particular uses in picture making, one of the problems existing in this particular picture is the nature of the movement of an elephant through the forest, and he's about to be attacked as the problem goes with the elephant. Not aware that the warriors are waiting for him, he's going to be driven toward a pit filled with stakes in the forest, and he'll be impaled upon them, of course taken prisoner, and there'll be a roast of elephant meat in the following, you know, projected ceremony of the native warriors. The elephant is Tarzan's friend, and so what has happened in this particular set of pictures is that the elephant has left Tarzan. Tarzan now is going through the jungle, and he'll suddenly be aware at one point that when he's seen how that pit was occurring, taking place, and I'll show you that in the next slide, what he'll do in relation to that. Now, these things are a disparity. They're not in full sequence, but I want you to see that in this picture, the nature of the movement is shown in the way we get a long shot in the first picture across the far top side of the pictorial layout. And so if you look at the first picture, you see you're looking at this as if you're looking over the top of the trees in toward the coming of the elephant down a jungle path. In the next picture, you're looking through the trees, and you're aware where the native warriors are, because they're seeing the elephant from here somewhere back there, and we have in our mind's eye, we remember where the elephant is. They're seeing that particular elephant from that vantage point. I just want you to see this is something like a movie sequence. What has happened here is that the gutter has been ruptured by the use of the tree, so that the tree here is binding all of the panels together, and that sense of binding together makes out of four pictures one picture. You follow this? I want you to get the feel, and very likely you see it already. It isn't just an abstraction that I want you to think that. We have to see it that way. And that tree is the binding element of all the pictures coming together. So that in the third panel, while the warriors are looking through the top of the tree, here we are looking over down in a different vantage point at the elephant coming. We know the elephant is coming to them because we do have them seeing it from the side plane. Third picture is that we're looking down from the ground level, and the warriors now are aware that the elephant is trudging because they're getting a signal from the top where he's saying he's coming. And the quarry here is about to approach, and then the elephant does approach, and the warriors come from underneath the root system at the bottom layer of the ground floor of the jungle and attack the elephant. So you have the business of seeing where we see the vantage point, the warriors see from the top through that way. Down at the bottom, the warriors are looking at the elephant through here, coming along, just about ready to be visible, coming around the bend. Suddenly we're aware that from the elephant's point of view, he is now about to undergo a murderous attack. The importance of the tree, however, is the nature of the ambling form of the elephant with his weaving movement and the kind of symbolic transition of the tree through the panels. This is the way that elephant takes his nice, easy, moving, sort of loping and swaying gait. And that's implicit in the way the tree is grown. You understand the solution to the problem? It isn't just a tree. It's a series of vantage points through which we see things according to other people's eyes. At the same time, it is a feeling instilled in terms of the kinetic and kinesthetic and tactile elements of the elephant in motion. It's an interesting problem. How would you solve it? Question is, if you're confronted with that, what is your pictorial representation of those elements? See, this picture is not only functioning on a visual action level, but on an emotional, interior, kinesthetic, and tactile view of how the elephant appears to be ambling through the woods. And what I'm saying is that all these pictures present different symbolic processes, which never has appeared in graphic narrative illustration before. Never. So if you were to ask me what's the importance of my input, I'm doing something nobody has ever done. Does that make sense? This is the picture where we get an understanding that Tarzan has been suddenly made aware that he, in his mind's eye, let's clarify that a little bit, In his mind's eye, he's aware that something is going on with what he had seen and remembers. He's gone into the tree after having left his friend the elephant. I want you to look at this design of the whole page. What breaks through the gutter is, in this particular picture, obviously a move that takes this kind of close-knit spiral, tight, opens up and comes down, winds down here, takes another tight spiral and winds in here, then moves in this motion like that. Do you see it coming up here like that and tying together and finally riveting on this eye, not that one? This is the outward eye, that's the inward eye. And you can see that it's tied in here to that kind of sight factor of riveting the eye and separating it from the head. What do you think of that, Simon?
Yeah.
That's very smart. What I wanted you to feel is that this winding together is a moment of concentration, a powerful moment of concentration, then it unwinds. And you see into the pupil of the eye what he sees. We're aware that this is his pupil. He sees the elephant in his mind's eye, looks back at it in memory, and leaps forward and hastens to help the elephant. And in those separate moments, in those sets of awareness, that, by the way, is a wonderful interior and exterior set of motives for the individual who is thinking, acting, and making decisions. And works immediately to forefend the possible danger. Going back, Tarzan has watched, in an earlier stage of this episode, some jungle men creating a pit there on the left, and notice how his left contorted leg is pointing down at the pit. And you can see that he's wrestling with an idea in the contortion of the tree. The tree is broken up so that we get four different panels, so to speak, four open spaces. One upper part, Tarzan to the right, middle part, warriors digging a pit in the middle left and putting in stakes. Lower part, where the stakes are being covered over with rods, bamboo rods, and right lower part, where they're being covered over with fronds and verdure, so that the whole thing is concealed, and we get the notion, as the expression is given on the bottom, that this is going to trap this great animal. The animal will come along, fall into the pit, get impaled, and they'll take the animal and destroy it. Tarzan is watching all this, wondering what's going on. And so the nature of his wonderment and the nature of his puzzlement is seen in the contortion of the trees. One leg points to the ultimate eventuality on the right. One leg shows the beginning of the pit. The two arms are expressing the nature of his idea of what, you know, intense concentration, and the look downward into the pit with the stakes and covered over, he realizes that is meant to be a concealed thing. And so now we have seen what Tarzan had remembered when he was down in the jungle, in the trees, remembering in his mind's eye that the elephant is coming, and he says, oh, that's what that was all about. The next slide here deals with the sudden move of Tarzan through the jungle in a very remarkable quick thrust into the forest. Now you, I'm sorry, remember when you showed me the ball? Hmm. See the figure?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The hand, the thumb, the arm, so on. That's the figure that was taken for that picture. And I wanted you to see that frequently things that I've done have been pirated. And so this figure was a pirated figure by somebody who had taken it for another use. But here he is going with an immense haste through the jungle and moving toward a destination where he's going to reach the elephant. The elephant here has been suddenly accosted by the warriors, and the warriors now are beating all kinds of making all kinds of sounds, beating the spears and yelling and screaming. Of course, the elephant in sheer terror is moving at a breakneck pace through the forest. And you can see, by the way, how it is that with the speed that Tarzan is coming in one direction, coming like this, and the form whipping around and takes us into this form like that, you can see now how the bond of the 2 pounds are overriding the gutter. You follow it? As it comes around here, comes the elephant, you look at the commotion created by the warriors and the ultimate disaster to the creature. See, the important thing in this kind of problem graphic novel or the graphic narrative, I'm sorry, is, I can bring it back.
You just push it back as long as you pull out the,
yeah,
the arm at the feet. Just push it back in. Then click.
If I push it back in?
Nice, okay?
All right, that's it.
Okay.
We read now from, if you look at the whole panel as a kind of designed continuum going from the left, upper left, into the further right on that upper panel, and then down now into the structure of the root system, it points you directly at the elephant on the further lower left, and then the accents on the blacks and the body are going to carry the eye upward, coming around like this, forcing the corn this way and burying across like that. You get a feel of this kind of tie-in. You follow that? Designing a page, designing the dynamics of the movement of the material. And the whole thing is a turbulent scene with all those pointed leaves having a certain set of spicule forms, creating a sense of piercing and pain. You see that down there under the elephant. And the elephant now is being diminished from a large creature to a form now pressed against the ground and then running away as if it's now minuscule in character and totally helpless. Looking at that from a higher elevation, the form gets smaller and diminished and superficial, and therefore we feel sorry for this creature who looks as if he's totally bereft and is obviously easy prey. You get the idea of you're drawing back to be able to diminish a creature where the power is gone from this big creature. You'll see later on we'll get him in bigger size when the need is to express it. Here, Tarzan has reached the elephant before. Obviously, he's just approached the pit. You can see the pit with some of the fronds and the growth pattern lying somewhat disturbed on the ground. And he's moving so fast that obviously you can't do this in two panels if we'd slow it up. So what I've done is multiply the movement by giving it two figures. So he comes down from the tree, bounces upward, and raises an arm and hurls himself toward the elephant crying, stop. And the elephant has reached such a state of consternation, falls back against his hind legs, lifting up in the fore. And it's really an interesting exercise in how to draw animals. Because these things, you cannot, by the way, find these in any kind of reference material. What do you do about it? You study enough animals, and then you begin to draw it, and then you begin to revise according to your own need, and then start to invent the action. So people say, you know, how creative are you? Well, you have to begin to invent. It won't happen in your mind, it won't happen. And so you can see the way in which the light hitting on the bottom of the foot pads are giving you a view of upcast light from the floor of the hot jungle. But the immediacy of that, and what I've done in a number of panels of different stories, is that when there's an eruption of a form, a denuded form like this with spicules and barbs and pointed material like thorns leaping and rising out of the ground, that, by the way, in other stories is a symbol of death. And in one of my Tarzan stories, Tarzan and the Apes, it appears in a fight between Tarzan and one of the great bull apes in two episodes. The form arises in the continuing fight where when the Tarzan meets the ape and then they join battle, you see the beginning of the death form. As the battle ensues, it forms on the side of the ape who's going to be undone. And at the end of that, the form envelops the ape. He goes down with a knife in his chest and then it disappears. The animal is dead. Excuse me. So this is the immediacy of that particular element of swift speed, swift movement in the body and the speed of change. I'm showing you different elements of symbology because the problem is one of the sense of the immediate solution to some of these problematic elements. Note the characteristic of the design of body, the animal, the legs, tusks, and the various elements of tension. The body comes on this way, leg rises that way, the form reaches down here, rises here, and goes down that way. See it? And here, like that. And those sets of diagonal concentrations, force structures, force directions, gives a feeling of urgency, a kind of concatenating urgency. I hope, you know, when you look at that, you'll get that sense of the way in which the two figures have been designed. And the elephant here has been made to breach away from the pit, which now has been overlaid with those fronds, is now going in a contrary direction. But we note that our hero has lost his balance. The elephant breaks through the thicket and runs away into the jungle. Tarzan lost his balance, comes down against the upstanding spikes in the ground. Obviously, we have to say that the suspense is big enough to make you feel as if it's the end for him. But luckily, agile fellow that he is, that's how he falls. In every way, his body takes on a contortion, and all those spikes miss his body in some way, flows right through the arm, goes right through the leg, you know, but in the way in which the leg is bent and twisted and so on. And he's fortunate in the sense that none has penetrated. But, you know, that's an interesting thing to play. And the wonder is obviously in the play, in the way that one sees the look of the body and how you play the form and how you create this kind of interesting arrangement, you know, these different shape directions.
Of course, Tarzan has the benefit of a benevolent creator in this art.
Oh, yes, yes, right. And the interest certainly in to keep the story going.
Absolutely.
Hey, fellas, you got to keep the story going. Anyway, I want you to see that as this group rises here from the head on the arm like that, up here we see at the top of the crest of the open pit, we see the amazement of the warriors wondering if this creature has survived. They reach down and pick him up, and you can read in here how these forms are devised and arranged. You read on these bamboo poles along this and coming down and driving down in here, and then we wind around and pick him up, and then this goes off in that direction. Can you see? Coming down this way. Can you read that? And I want to tell you, when you start thinking of devising how to shape this or that panel, you're always working on this one to get to that one, and this one to get to that one. You see it? Read the pointing devices. Read this in here, from here to there, to there, to there. Those are the subtle distinctions. They're cues to the eye and the kinetic drift.
How conscious are you aware of when you...
Pardon me?
How conscious are you aware of that when you start? What comes first?
Well, what comes first is when I put these pages together on an easel, I have 1, 2, 3. As a matter of fact, when the figure moves it here, the next action on the next page will move to something starting here and will go off in that direction. Where this one is pointing, that's where the next one begins. So you take a line like this, a line like that, and on that line, which is a line of excitement, you put these beads of interest.
So you really make a skeleton first?
No, what I do is lay down a line of design flow, where it's going. The way I showed you, the way in which this eye, the head of Tarzan, went like that on the arm, closed up, and then on the other arm came down here like that. Remember? The one with the close-up of Tarzan. You do that first, and then you know where the drawing is going, because if you don't know that, you're dead in the water. You're guessing all the time, and you don't know what's happening, and that is what's called the plot line, the scenario, right? The whole thing worked out as a synoptic view. The synoptic view means a general overview. And so you see here where Tarzan has been lifted out of the pit. And through this, by the way, you have to go ahead and devise ways in which these figures will actually look. And they have to work in relation to how to convince that you're looking at this with your sense of reality. Otherwise, you won't believe it at all if it's badly done. And then, obviously, you have to have the skill to make it work and be convincing. So, how do you get the skill? You have to do 10,000 figures before you do the next 10, and those next 10 afterward would be the ones that you'd probably be satisfied with. Which means to say, there's no end to the work of it, and at the same time, at the end of all that time, you may be pretty damn good to be able to draw anything. So these figures are obviously both dramatic, intense, satisfying, and of course, very likely convincing. So here we have our hero bound up, and the chief is making all kinds of threatening gestures. He's been taken prisoner, he'll be incarcerated, and then there's going to be a great celebration, and in an execution scene, he'll be put to death. So the king here is ordering. Remember what I said about where that panel ended? It ended somewhere in here, and goes up here, drives down, and has this general drift from here downward into here and there. You just sort of feel that kind of drift in here. And this is going up and down in here, and this horse coming into the other side, leaving the figure tilting that way. Design on this level, by the way, is not tentative. It's very specific and has a very, how shall I say, a directed aim at things without being over-subtle. What you want to do is create directness in communicating, because the reader has no education in these things and it's subtle to him. But if you make it that clear, you'll be able to get a kind of intuitive sense as to where it's going. If you look at the way in which these two figures are interesting, in that figures knit together that way, see it like this in here, and this figure is going quite the opposite way. See it? This is going this way, this is going that way. You see this direction in here, those are elements of similarity, but the opposite leg of the drift, one way and the other way. The arms backward this way, the arms back that way. But what's interesting in this particular set of panels is not the figures as much as the masks. The masks are bearing information. Figures passive here, the face is passive, those faces are passive, these faces are passive. But look at the mask here of an undoubted feeling of revenge. And then the pronouncement of the death sentence and the death threat in here in the head, the skull given next to our hero. And then here we get a mask showing the moment of the execution, calling for the death thrust. You can see the three different qualities of expression on those masks, as if they are now kind of a super animated, or what we call an anthropomorphic element, a form of living entity in these inanimate objects. Implied animism in the form. And then here we have the individual looking at the preparation for the execution. And in the end, he's aware of his own doom, and what should he do about it? No one has ever played inanimate objects as the interior of expressions of emotion, with the exception of some artists, let's say, by James Ensor. Do you ever see James Ensor in Carnival and other things like that? You're aware of some interior emotion of Edvard Munch, who plays out a painting called Puberty, another painting, Puberty. A little girl sits on the edge of a desk, at the edge of a bed, with an enormous shadow bounding two-thirds of the picture behind her head and body at the back wall. And it's called Puberty, and you see the little girl huddled up, naked, and the shadow is obviously the immense fear generated by the first show of blood as an apprehension filling the room. And here is what I wanted to get as a feeling of the masks, conveying that anthropomorphic element, as the shadow in an Edvard Munch picture conveys fear. You follow that? And that's how you might want to look at pictures. How can you get these things working for you? In the next picture, he seeks to make a break, and as he's making a break, the mask in back is like somebody who is now witnessing a jailbreak, and says, "Oh my God, the prisoner's escaping." See what the mask back there is doing? It's like a cry for help. And this little figure here, this little animistic form, is actually now as if it's, suddenly taken unaware, intelligence. And then the cry for help, watch out, or whatever, he's getting away. And this one is saying, helplessness in this mask. You see the feeling of being born backward. And if you read those scenes, you're going to be tied into the emotions of what's going on when he makes a sudden break as if to get away. Then the warriors come and apprehend him, take him in tow, and then here, thank God. He came just in time. Because after all, in a sense, these masks are on their side, not our hero's side. And so they're going to march him off to the execution hill. That's pretty sophisticated stuff when you consider the nature of some of these forms as elements in a story, and yet they're there almost as simple decoration. But if in this kind of public, where the public is interested in everything going on, what's interesting about young people, as well as people in the lore of something called this kind of picture and picture making, they love to see details. Remember how when you were a kid, you loved to see all those details? When you start to see the details, it not only is not only interesting, but you begin to read them. Hey, fellas, I can read this stuff. And it has a marvelous interior, intrigue. How the Tarzan struggle is manifested by the stuff that's being kicked around in the background. He's a very energetic type, and nothing stands still when he moves. Here he's been carried out into the open. The warriors are moving along, and at one point he realizes this is no time to fool around, and he lifts his voice in a great yell, and he calls for Tantor, in the elephant language. And somewhere that sound is going to carry out into the jungle, and now since he is broken into that sound, they hustle him quickly, and here is the look of a great howl of rage. Get him up there! Can you see it on the outer right? And those are real exaggerated burlesque-like motions, powerful sort of kinesthetic elements. Expressing rage in here and expressing the violence of the emotion of an order given. When you flip these pages, I don't know if you'll ever get to see that, but what if you don't? It's not as if I didn't do it. If you don't see it, that's your fault.
Every time I look at the page, I see something different than the same page.
Here he is on the execution hill. Look at this mask at the top saying, baby, now you're going to get it.
Just to say, no, I got you, my grip.
Yeah, and our hero is standing there, waiting for that moment when he may make a break or whatever may happen. Notice that he's tethered by the neck and the arms. His legs are free here. And look at these other masks, various expressions of people in the crowd. This mask, that mask, that mask. The others are really quite passive in character. Only the chief and the individual, calling attention to the pronouncement of death is about to give the signal. And then, when he does give the signal, at that point, our hero, in a burst of rage, breaks loose from these bonds, and if he couldn't do it, there'd be no point to being a hero at all. So you have to see that kind of wild thrust of the multiplication of one of the legs in one of those great taut moves where it was bent at one point, and then the kick outward is where he kicks those things off the hill and makes the break. And these heads in here on the far side of the lower right, you take a look at these faces, oh my God, just the way you would feel if you were to say, look what happened. Next slide, he breaks loose. Try this sometime in some of your drawing. they say that, people like to draw the figure. This, by the way, is total invention. It's one thing you get a model in front of you and say, I felt inspired and I made that drawing, But the inspiration is nothing when it's compared. It's not the first figure you draw, it's the second one, and the third one, and the fourth one, and they all bear on the same problem and the same principle of proportion and foreshortening. So here's how that organizes. The whole picture is a series of violent fighting diagonals. It goes up here, here, like this, you know, downward in here. These angular thrusts in here. You read it, and this, 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 this. You can see it in here coming up like that, that, you know, around the far side, and the interior dynamics of these lightning stroke diagonals. That's what's holding the picture together, and that's its simplicity. The structural elements. What is structure if it isn't the way your eye flows through the picture? Which is why when you have yourself a set of design flow elements, you're bound into that, and you've got to create figures for that. Otherwise, why did you do it? Then they've got to be your own. And if they're not your own, you may have some reference, you make it your own. You have to wrench those figures where you'd have a piece of clay and mold it, play it. And so that'll give you a chance for structuring and learning. This elephant, the elephant now has caught the sound and has come to the palisade of the village and makes a determined smash against it. You see the whole wall going down with the weight of the elephant butting against it. And it's obvious that we see the elephant from one side, on our side with the warriors. They have that jagged line coming in one side and the jagged line of the wall following that kind of distorted line of the warriors. And then the force of it, the heave of the animal is like a buttress and a ram, battering ram coming in here. The wall buckles and these are buckling men even more wild and disordered. You follow that in that motion? And then from the other side, look at the expression given here on these masks. Look at this. The awareness of danger, the cry of a sense of despair. And then the elephant is broken through. And from both sides, again, to convince one and the other how these forms begin to act. The warrior is on the far side, the broken palisade, and the elephant is about now to make his thrust. Now the warriors act backward. One is ready to heave the spear, and the king is yelling, stop him, stop him, stop him, and so on, go get him. And you can see one on the other side, and there's Tarzan in the back, hurling men around. You have the twist of one side, the twist of the other, and the kind of contradictory twists going on. Shape form on one side against the other shape forms on the bottom. And you see the backward and forward movement, which gives you a sense of the wrenching of the bodies. And here the elephant has broken through, picked up our hero, still bound, carries him through the broken palisade, and off he goes into the jungle with him and disappears into the mists of the forest. You can see how these two forms, these vectors, you know, the power of this breakthrough, but this drives you straight down to our hero going off into the mist. Notice this drop off from here. All with deliberate intent, no shilly-shallying about it. I want to tell you, storytelling on this basis, truly, if you look at any comic book or any story, has never been told this way in this kind of sequence, nor really in any movie, with the exception maybe of a few French motion picture directors like René Clair, in a motion picture on Nous la Liberté going years back, where he directed a crowd on a wild, you know, a great open square in Paris, and he had a bunch of people chasing one another, and they were orchestrated to move in a series of snake-like forms running all through this thing. And I never forgot that. I said, my God, it's not a mob, it's a dance. And you could follow those movements, and all these people running, and it was a tremendous thing to see. And I thought, gee, this thing is marvelous choreography, and I never forgot that. That's when the eye, Max Friedlander says, the eye sleeps until the intelligence wakes it with a question. And that's a thing you should never forget if you want to draw it right. Here then is the savior elephant in the moment of salubrity and peace. A great jungle setting, but there's always this wonderful feeling of all things quieting down and the healing waters and the elephant. The two good friends are together and the war is over. It's the last picture in the story. I wanted to show you some other miscellaneous symbolic events in the story called Tarzan's First Love. He was in love with Kala, the great ape, his mother, in the jungle, but she got killed. And so as we see Tarzan going through trees, he looking backward, the leaves turn into little heart shapes of love, and this is his great mother who once lived and is now dead. And this is, he tilts toward her in remembrance. As he holds on to that vine, it's a thorny vine, that's his deep sadness and pain, and how it turns into love for her. And then his body pulls another vine with that pain, and that's Tika, his girlfriend, his eighth girlfriend, with whom he's in love now, he thinks, because she resembles so much Kala, his mother. You see the kind of tie-in, like a love knot. And one day he looks down into the forest, and the animals roaming through. He ponders about Tika and his love for her, and you can see how that love is carried in, and his body is all knotted up with a certain kind of, how shall I say, confusion of directions. And so he comes from here in here, looking down, and he sees all the animals of the forest have somebody whom they belong to, like the lion and the lioness. And his thought, obviously, is there one for me? As he goes further, he sees his girlfriend Tika down there, and she's being pursued by another ape. And Tarzan is mad about that. He doesn't understand his feelings, but the hair on his head gets real spiky. You know, like thoughts. You're rankling in his thought process. You can see also that what was a tree before, with these vines, has now turned into this thorny process with these prickly things that give pain. Can you read that out? And the pain is here, right here in the top of his head.
And at the back, it looks like a fan of spines. It looks like a fan.
And he's enmeshed in all of that wild tangle, as if to say this is really something that's got him deeply troubled, you know, when you're all knotted up in thought. So one day he takes a look at Tika's hand, or, you know, his, they're close together, and he sees something very strange. His hand is never anything like hers. Now hers like his. And you can see that the thorny, those vines winding around his hand are more delicate, hers are more coarse and gross. And his eye, fingers framing his eye, the inward eye again. Do you see how those fingers are framing an eye, the eye of insight and intelligence? All through that thought process in the eye, these horns winding around. Every animal has a counterpart, whether it's the birds or the leopard or the monkeys or whether the lions and whether the deer and so on. They all have similarity, but he and Tika are not similar. Comes to that conclusion. Well, the story goes on with a lot of adventure. In the end, of course, he concedes to his friend, this great big bull ape, go on, take Tika, she's yours, after an adventure that proves to him that Taug is truly his friend, not his enemy, and Tika really doesn't belong to him. And Tarzan, he says, in a last moment of decision to take himself out into the world and leave the founding of a family to the ape who belongs to the ape, because he senses difference, and he says, go take her, she's yours. And the ape says to Tarzan, Tarzan has found another she, says Taug. And there is no answer to that, because we know very well he hasn't. But take a look and see how it is that our hero, for whatever it is that the jungle represents, the barren tree, the uprooted roots, are this orphan of the wild who has no growth and no green. It's all blasted stuff, and the only growths are down in here, but the uprooted barren material is up there, and he casts a shadow, and the shadow is always out there. That's trouble. And notice the symbol of his inner self, not just apprehension or not just remorse, but a sense of determination, but a feeling of doom that will haunt him because he is really a loner. And see that implied head in the projecting spines of the upper tree? You read it? Did you see that before?
When you in Louisville.
But not before.
No, you, not before then. No.
Yeah, you have to educate your eye to look at those things.
That's right. It's so much to read into it.
So there's always something in the outside world that is giving us the cue to what is going on. In part of the story, Tarzan is sitting with Tika. She's sitting in his lap, this poor, innocent, nice creature, and he's holding this vine, feeding her these lovely, juicy tidbits. And she's having a great time with a little kid, and Tarzan looking at her studiously. And in the upper panel, he regards her face as if, you know, from a distance. And then the right panel up, the comparison of the two hands. The two hands are really not the same, but it's almost like a Michelangelo with God and Adam, you know, creating contact, but it's the wrong contact entirely here. And then with the body all knotted up and twisted so we feel this kind of thing. Her body is more lyrical and moving, but his body is all knotted up in these angular twists. And then he sees a fragment here, he's a fragment here, he's a fragment here, and he's a fragment here, but Tika's whole, she's whole, she's whole. You get it? She's the whole thing, belongs there. He is only the broken man. And so here he gets up and leaves her, and she wonders, why did Tarzan get up and where is he going? He takes off and goes into the jungle in his feeling of alienation. You get the sense in the way that this is moving through here, 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 here. Okay? Divides up in two places and comes back. That's pretty damn sharp design. In another story, he kills a snake. What I wanted to show is the power, the directness of the blow, and the tortured feel of the snake writhing in his hands. And there's a symbol of death on the upper left. See it? Mm-hmm. Oh, that's one of my pieces from Tibetan shrine play. I'm going to show you some personal pieces and then I'll stop. This is a pen and ink drawing in a sequence of drawing without penciling, just simply building the drawing and finishing as you go. And actually, it's a preparation toward an etching, the way an etching would be developed. And it's in the Baroque manner of 17th century Dutch painting. Chinese man, kind of inspired with the time of New China and the quality of this proud man who is nobody's slave and nobody's master, but, you know, making a statement for the world. And the thing is painted with a razor blade. You know, I wanted to feel that the razor blade is kind of an engrossing and kind of tough, stubborn treatment of a tool on a surface, and so that you can move directly with it and have a sense of authority in the not just the brush, but in the way the color is applied. And so the act of painting is also a declaration, as it is in the treatment of the image. You follow that? To me, the act or the stroke is as much an act like pitching a baseball. You can't throw a slow ball and strike the man out and create a dazzling whiz through. You know, you can't ride a fast race in a slow bicycle. So, you know, the whole idea is a certain kind of straightforward attempt to create histrionics, calligraphy, and choreography. The treatment of, with a fountain pen drawing of two vagrant people and they look at the world as feeling this terrible sense of loss and friendlessness, and here is that implied cross in here, as if to say, but where is mercy? The African people from that monolithic thing we call Darkest Africa once came alive and were given recognition by the United Nations, and they became sentient living people and turned into nations, and they were then a certain kind of world humanity. The monolith has now developed nerve ganglia, which are coming alive and having sensitivity to feeling. We feel that the whole different creature, the whole different person, is not just impersonal, but something of an extraordinary different human being. I'll never forget one time in the New York subway at the time when the blacks were moving in the middle 60s and late 60s toward 70, the whole slogan with Malcolm X and the Black Panthers, that black is beautiful. One day I went in the New York subway and here's a black man standing in front of a gum machine looking at himself, and then turns around and I'm walking by and he looks and has looked in the mirror and looks at me, and he follows me as I'm walking back, and I'm walking past and I'm following his gaze, and the phrase rings in my ear that he's looking to see how black is beautiful, and for the first time I'm aware that he's aware that I'm aware. And we have this strange sense of community and discontinuity at the same time. And it was a very uncomfortable moment, because usually you walk past these people and they are, as Ralph Ellison said, the invisible man. But this fellow was not invisible anymore. And that's this moment of coming alive.
Vern, you didn't raise your hand then and went
No, but he almost did. I could just feel they gave him another little, you know, as a motive to do so, he would. I was thinking of developing some kind of picture of a bull, and here is a kind of a wounded bull. And these, by the way, have no just drawing of the animal. Mm-hmm. You draw enough photographs and, you know, different aspects of looking at, you know, reference matter, and you sort of memorize the quality of forms. And it occurred to me, the sense of the bull in the bullfight, I was trying to imply in here a kind of form, a fertility form. While the bull dies, something remains, you know, that feeds the tribe. And then it became something more concrete and correct. This is that drawing that I did for the School of Visual Arts. Now is the time to enroll, really. But it was a moment of two colliding forms, of the movement in here was the movement of that bull doing this, and everything was carried in with a totality design and the tail and the streamers in the wrinkle system and the cape and so on. All of that had that kind of humping, striding, forceful gait, and the collision of two forces. Feel it? There is my watercolor sketch, which I did in about 3.5-4 minutes, of that other drawing. And that became part of the next painting, with the motif of this in here, but I had to exaggerate that. It became the Venus of Willendorf. In here it looks like this. And it's called The Recollection of Lascaux. Lascaux, the great cave with the bulls on it, and going back 20,000 years, the hand of the hunter. And it once fed the tribe, today in our day, the moment of truth and the moment of death. Here is the Venus of Willendorf. Here's that form right in here. You see it? The goddess of fertility. And here the big belly, the body and the breasts, and the whole thing is a sense of what is important to the world. But we've forgotten that, because the bull in that moment creates death. You know, the bull is an instrument of death in the bullfight. So on the wall, this bullfight is being acted out. In the modern world, here is the beginning of a nuclear reaction. And those little gleaming energy explosions on the subatomic level become now volatile and about ready to erupt into a very great explosion. And little mutation forms are occurring along the edge here, and you see it. And the progenitor and the the instigator of all this is also the victim of it, because look at the death head that is emerging from this man of intelligence, starting out of the first inspiration of, you know, awareness in his eye, you know, how he sees this great idea. And then the eruption takes place, the animal charges, the hand of the hunter, where before was a great hunter in antiquity of a profile of the hand, a contour of the hand, has now become a death's hand. And then here is a cry of pain. See the lower part of the face in here? And what happens is the flame in the world burns up, and it's the little child dying away in here in flames. That's the future going up. Can you see it? This is truly a self-portrait. On the lower left, you see, you know, me. That's really painted in my thumb. Different paint, pushing. By the way, the original is just a little bit bigger than this, about like that. It's almost that size. There are two kinds of creation. One is the creation of inspiration and life. The other is, if in creation you have no sense of inspiration with life and the resolution in living things, then the other way of creating is quite clearly...
Give you a little more height.
Yeah, fine. Terrific. And the other way of creating, if we can lift this up a little bit.
Yes, I think I can. Yes, of course. Hang on.
All right. Just lift the front legs a little bit.
Yes, no, it's coming up. It winds down this way, so it brings up the other way.
It's called the square root of X. X, the square root of the unknown. Thank you. I think that's good. And so, as Eric Fromm says, there are two ways to create. One is to create when you believe in life, and the other is to create when you don't believe in life. You have no way, then obviously your creative processes are all destructive. And destruction is another sense of creating something, but something that the world notices. So this is the negative side of creation and the positive. And out of the creative mind springs an idea that evolves and then transforms and then becomes now, you know, a form of, in, how shall I say, transformation further. And then there is a catalytic moment, a cathartic moment of the rise of a new thing called the idea, the birth of an inspiration. And that's created as an artist or as a great poet would do it. And then here is, then the destructive act of creation is to take whatever grows and then you destroy it. It goes up in flames. Well, this is, you know, a comment on the modern world and modern life and the kind of life we all know about today and out there, the wasteland. According to T.S. Eliot, what is left? A cubist intervention here, painting like a cubist, the man of labor in a realist mode, and what he has created in terms of how everything is depends upon his art and artifice. So you have the buildings and the brickwork and then the walls and then the factories grow and then the things that are made into the great shapers of things, and then they become bigger buildings and the big chimneys and here the steel mills. Then they become things fashioned out of the factories and out of the steel mills into buildings and elevators and the rising things, the interior and exterior, into new and modern elements and into the absolutely new for which we have no name for yet, and that's the guy who shapes the world. And that has, as you can see, much of it is textural material put down with a stylus or stick, and the other is painting with a razor blade all through this thing, and quick strokes of a brush bounding the forms.
Is that about the same size, Ben?
Yes, it would be about the same size. Maybe a little bit bigger. Coming down the last two or three pictures, you can see that my viewpoint on these things is not the sprightly nudes of a September morning.
you upset him.
But you see, I don't hold to those people who just feel that they have to pander to the public as well as to the paycheck, as well as to the labels of the sales tags and so on, and all the people who make the palaver and the art columns. I say, the hell with that. They can't buy my head. Here's the solution of a man who is doomed forever. Oppenheimer said, now when he created the atom bomb, now he said, I am become death, according to the statement, what, in Revelation, he reads out those lines. And so you have here this figure holding, soaring up this miasmal cloud of poisonous matter from some great disaster below, lighting up the, from below, here on the lower forms of the body, and then the forms here in the clouds of dust and the gaseous fumes, holds aloft this head of the dead bull, like the other one. But notice how he can never get rid of it, because here he is, you see. And he's doomed forever to hold that and can't get rid of it. And that's our lot, your lot, our destiny.
It's all about satanic, isn't it? It's like the Satan is satanic.
That's a powerful image.
Does that depend on the mood as well?
So you ask, you know, what do I paint? These are things I paint.
Oh,
yeah.
That's more to it.
He's woken up already.
This is called an icon of worship of the Moon Queen. The Moon Queen is the woman of the world. You know, she plies her trade day and night in the stockings. You can see that. And she wears these seductive garments. And in this garment, you see the head of the destroyer, Kali, in here. See it? And all who enter here abandon all hope. But, you know, anyone who has the courage will meet the goddess of love in there. There's a Venus of Willendorf. You know, she was once a great fertility goddess of the world. And today she's seen in the guise of a call girl, a woman who, you know, walks the street in Broadway with the lights. Listen, when the room is dark and these things are imposed on the surface, by the way, little glittering forms that come from showbiz. And they look like Broadway after dark. You won't see it in this dark room because in the picture they'll start to glow, you know, when you see the original. But the point I'm making about this thing is that she sings her siren song. She sits in a tower of position. This is the tree of life. The masculine penal forms and the feminine vaginal forms and the roots. The lotus is the everlasting root system of the tree of life. The alpha and the omega of all things is equivalent. That which makes everything go is the dollar sign. And on the lower left, you see the champagne, you know, celebrating the two modern constructs of energies in the world, sex and violence. That's what makes everything go. And here then is what we find on the American dollar bill, obviously, in the upper corner, the pyramid and the eye. And then in the world around, it's the ancient world was the eye, obviously, of the divine intelligence and the great fire mountain, the pyramid, and the seven magical days of the week. It's a magical number. That's why seven is a great number. And then you find also the U with the flowering plant, and the P and the X is a cryptic name in Greek called Cairo, the cryptic name of Christ. But in our time, it's celebrating the sacred pyramid, which is the dollar, and the other side is 7-Up. So it's a kind of a double construct of these obviously great venerated thoughts of mythic value in the world, at the same time satirical elements of sardonic laughter.
Is that an acrylic?
What's that? No, it's an oil painting. Well, it's in oil. It's about, this is 2/3 the size, about this size in here, like that. Very big, bigger picture.
It's a very cruel picture of women.
What's that?
A very cruel picture.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, this picture celebrates women. It tells you that she was once a great mother goddess of the world, sitting and venerated, you know, as a great icon, but today she's been produced by modern society, not I. I'm telling you the truth about her. And you see her in a double mode through a two-kind mind screen.
It's a false thing.
It's their opinion that she is a call girl. She was once a goddess.
But there's something in the middle.
What? Well, the point about it is, you know, you can play it on yourself. When you see these lovely women walk down the street and you see their youthful faces and so on, and you see them thirsting for life and what do they have to do but drink soda pop and take Coke and all the rest of it, what does your mind tell you? That these are competing themes in the world.
Yeah, but that's a
and I'm telling you, go look at it, see your competing themes. It's a hard-edged look at it, but it's not the artist's opinion. It's the artist saying, this is the world's opinion. And I'm asking you, go make a choice. With all of these things, these pictures say, go make a choice against that hard news.
But that's the little
point. What?
I'm so disgusted now.
You haven't caught my point of view in the other, earlier pictures, otherwise, if you take this point of view now, then why should I turn tables on you now? What I'm trying to say in here, if you saw the rest of this, you would see that this is the sheaf of wheat, and in here are the signs of gambling. You gamble with a sheaf of wheat. So you don't believe in the life process of the sacred, you know, Ankh of the great Egyptian, you know, cross, but all you do is you believe in good luck. And good luck, somebody's got to lose when somebody wins. The truth about gambling is that how do people get something for nothing when other people get nothing for something? That's the hard news, and you better hear that in your ears. Right, that's what this picture is all about. Don't believe it one way or the other, but believe, you know, when you see it, what's the other side of the bag? I gave you the two creative systems earlier. Make your choice.
I'm showing you two sides of the coin at the same time.
There's a picture, there's part of the picture missing. How do you like my different techniques? See, and all of these I'm pretty damn good at.
These depend on moves when you draw these.
Powerful moves, yes, and they all depend on touch and stroke and surface and everything else. Matter of fact, what's missing here? My photographer missed the hand. It was holding a rook, which is a castle in a chess game. And the point about this guy sitting in that rickety position in this turbulent, misbegotten world, like Rodin's thinker, he says, where the hell do you put the rook to castle in? Where's your security? Where do you make safety come out in this miserable scheme of things? That's what the picture's all about. Answer the question.
Decisions.
Sure. This is reflection on our theme of decision theory. Oh, nicely the reds are placed. See them floating in here? Like spots of blood through it.
And that red there seems very practically 3D. It comes out actually.
The right hand side.
Right. Yes, it's
very
deep.
It's
like fresh blood, actually.
And the last picture. Turn it the other way, Frank.
Yes, of course.
Just to show the cynics that the artist can paint.
I'll adjust it, yeah.
This picture is much bigger than the given thing here. I think we have to bring the image. Right.
Yes, I can do it.
Bring the thing closer.
I'll bring it closer if you like.
Yeah. This is called Abel, my brother.
A little closer or not?
That's fine. It's just right.
Okay.
You're right on. All the black people, the colored people, you know, you beat them, you scourge them, you denigrate them. Betray them, string them up, truss them in barbed wire, gag them, give them a blindfold, and the blindfold is money, and then throw them out onto the barren earth, and that's what this is all about. And the idea is, this is your brother Abel. So you, Cain, what did you do to him? Some people say, I couldn't live with a picture. All right. You want to be deadheads, what do you live with? People say, oh, I couldn't live with that picture. Well, who's asking you? Don't buy it. But then I know where your head is. After all, you read The Toilers of the Sea by Victor Hugo, Grapes of Wrath by John Steinbeck. You read the Lower Depths by Gogol and others and so on, and so you have to say that There is a literature in the world, there is a conscience in the world, and it's not a morality, it's not afflicted with guilt, but it's a statement of how it is you see yourself in that context, in that relationship. So I let you view it like this. Anyway, that's the end of the picture show.
Lovely.